My name is Andreana.
And my name is Anne.
Today we have Representative Dhruv from the Texas Republican Party and Representative Bailey from the Texas Democratic Party.
My name is Dhruv Vishwanath, and I am a representative from the city of Dallas, Texas.
Good evening. I'm Bailey Hodakovic, and I am a representative of the great city of Austin, Texas.
So now let's start with our first question. President Trump in 2017 made the controversial decision to withdraw from the 2015 Paris Agreement, which had been signed by 197 countries. According to Trump, being part of this climate agreement negatively impacts the economy by lessening jobs for U.S. laborers, such as coal miners, and increases taxes for Americans. Do you believe that these statements are valid? And if so, should they affect the nation's decision as we move forward?
So the Paris Agreement was a way that the world was misleading the public upon how climate change is in our world and a way to reduce jobs for Americans. As a result of this, I agree with the actions of our president, Donald J. Trump. A specific issue that has risen from this is the limitations that would be implemented on coal usage in the nation. The current issue is that national leaders are trying to undermine the hard work and nature of the coal miners and their families, all for the purpose of being able to push the agenda that there is need for cleaner resources. Ironically, coal is a clean, reliable, abundant, and affordable domestic resource. It is with these facts that the decision to move forward with climate change discussions should be able to consider families in the energy industry and energy that is reliable.
So when discussing how to mitigate the effects of climate change, it's imperative that we work with those who will be impacted by the shift to green energy. While Donald Trump's claims are inaccurate and further advances in misconceptions regarding the impact of the Paris Accords, he is raising the concerns of his base, namely declining rates in the job in the fossil fuel industry. Under President-elect Joe Biden's Build Back Better plan, provisions have been added for coal miners and their families to secure benefits they have earned and outlined the establishment of a task force on coal and power plant communities to ensure that those in the coal industry are not left behind. As it pertains to the economy, the Paris Agreement, which Biden's Build Back Better plan aims to meet, will not lessen jobs available for everyday Americans, but rather expand the middle class and create millions of good-paying union jobs. Although the price of such measures are substantial, it can easily be paid for by reversing Trump's tax cuts. Although this is not ideal in the eyes of my Republican colleagues, it is more costly to do nothing, since rising temperatures could cost the U.S. $520 billion annually in 22 economic sectors.
President-elect Joe Biden's website states that he will make sure the U.S. achieves a 100% clean energy economy and reaches net zero emissions no later than 2050. This would include investing in and subsidizing clean energy and climate research and innovation in order to incentivize a rapid transition to green technology to meet his goal. Do you believe that the use of taxpayer money to subsidize the climate change effort is justified? Or should sustainable development be left to the private sector?
So I would have to disagree with this. I don't believe taxpayer money should be spent on companies with renewable energy. The government should not be playing favorites with energy producers of the nation. Doing so will only cost taxpayers money, and that could go towards companies that end up not even producing a kilowatt of energy. What a waste of money. We believe that the government should treat all marketable energy producing companies fairly. This means not providing subsidies for companies, even for those that use coal, oil, and nuclear power. Other sources such as wind and geothermal energy can be developed by the private companies that would want to invest in those resources. This cost-effective development would be able to expand those areas of energy while keeping tax money for more important issues for the nation, such as national security.
While I disagree with my Republican counterpart, I believe that there is merit in eliminating the $20 billion in subsidies to the fossil fuel industry each year, which, as Dhruv stated, could be directed towards other issues. If this were to happen, green energy would be more competitive due to soaring gas prices and heating and cooling bills. Of course, this is unlikely to happen because of the fossil fuel industry's lobbying efforts. Therefore, the government must create a fair advantage for both industries by subsidizing renewable energy, which would make green energy more competitive and increase demand, which the private sector would supply in order to retain profits. While taxpayer money must first be used, the cost of such measures can quickly be recovered since the U.S. would be decreasing its reliance on foreign nations for energy. This not only enhances national security, but creates new economic sectors, which often provide higher paying jobs as compared to the fossil fuel industry.
Many climate change activists are members of our youngest generation who are fighting for their beliefs regarding environmentalism and corporate intervention. One of these fighters is Greta Thunberg, a 17-year-old Swedish activist. What are your thoughts on the youth, using Greta Thunberg as an example, being on the forefront of climate change activism?
I completely agree that the youth should be involved, especially because they are the future electorate and will dramatically influence local, state, and federal elections when they come of age. Because social media has led to increased social awareness and more political engagement, we've seen international action and insight as to which direction we should be going. As for the U.S., the 2020 election was proof of that, especially with such young voter turnout. It often takes new perspectives to initiate change, and Gen Z and the Alpha generation will be forced to live on this planet long after the older generations are gone. Lawsuits over the lack of a response to the climate crisis, such as Juliana versus the United States, where 21 adolescents, ages ranging 8 to 19, sued the federal government for violating their rights to a safe climate, are proof of that. By understanding issues most pressing to the youth, lawmakers are able to promote legislation that addresses these issues or face tough election cycles, especially in 2024, when most of Gen Z will be of voting age.
Okay. I agree to an extent with my Democratic colleague. As a Republican, we believe that the main issue with climate change is conservation of our country's land. So that being said, our younger generation is really important in this. Our younger generation should be able to have a voice that could be able to tell what is being done with controlling our public land. So with that being said, states should be given more right to public land, as states have the ability to open land to people and ensure that the land is properly taken care of, as locals know what is best for the land. With the voice of the younger generation, public lands can be more effectively taken care of, preserved, and used to help reduce the amount of climate change that we have within our nation and help change the world.
Well, that is all for today's interview. Thank you to both correspondents for your time.
Up next, a horde of wild hogs blocks I-10 after escaping from a transport van. More on this after the break.